God's grace and peace be with you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, good morning.
Good morning.
Look at all you. You're awake this morning. I was up at 3 o'clock. I think I had adrenaline left over from the UConn game. I just could not get to sleep. Good game, though. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, we seek to find a place for you here at First Congregational Church. We hope you find peace and uplift in our worship and a place in the full life, leadership, and ministry of the congregation. Welcome to all who have no church home, to all who need strength, to all who want to follow Christ, to those with doubts, and to those who don't believe at all. Welcome to new visitors and to old friends. Welcome to grandparents and mothers, fathers, single people, and children of all ages. Welcome to people of all colors, cultures, abilities, sexual orientations, gender expressions, and gender identities. However the rest of the world may describe you, or however you describe yourself, you are welcome to join us on our joint journey, guided by the Holy Spirit, to love God and follow in the ways of our Savior, Jesus Christ. So good morning to all. And if you could just turn and wave to the camera so anybody online at home can be welcomed here too. Good morning, all.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
Good morning. I would sing, "Oh, what a beautiful morning," but everybody knows I can't sing. So we'll go right to the call to worship. Please join me. Come, children of God. Come and believe in the good news of Jesus' resurrection. In steadfast love and faithfulness, God has done marvelous things. So let us lift up our hearts to God in joyful praise and song. Please join me in hymn number 228, and if you could stand and sing joyfully, I'm sure God will appreciate that.
Thank you.
bulletins, but we're going to do announcements this morning. And I know there's a flower announcement.
Say something.
You. Okay, thank you. Is it on? Okay. On behalf of the Facilities Committee, I wanted to take a moment to recognize and thank Linda Cunningham. Linda, can you stand up so people can see who you are if they don't know? For those of you not aware, Linda was our committee chair for the Facilities Committee for the last 4 years, making sure that the grounds and building were all in good repair. There's quite a few behind-the-scenes things that Linda was responsible for, like plumbing and heating contractors and painting contractors and organizing our cleanup days and our snow removal. So Linda, the flowers are for you, and we want to say thank you.
Thank you, Linda.
But this is not goodbye, because we really still need you to bring the cookies to our church cleanup days. We really need that. So. And also, I want to say thank you to Rob Lentz for stepping up as our new chair. And sorry, Rob, no flowers for you.
Now, before we ask for any other announcements, I was talking to my wife this morning, and we were watching Channel 3, and she says, where are we going to watch the eclipse? And then she says, you know, the backyard at the church is a good place to watch the eclipse, don't you think? So we're going to be here around 2 o'clock. If anybody wants to come down to watch the eclipse, we got a big backyard with lots of room, and I think it'll be a good place to see it. All right, so.
I have an announcement about the Southern New England Conference Women's Connection meeting that's coming up on April 27th. And it's going to be a day-long event, and you can register online under the Southern New England Conference site, but also there's forms down in Fellowship Hall if you'd like to go. You need to get your registration in before April 17th. It includes a worship time that will be in the sanctuary in the afternoon. In the morning, there's going to be a dynamic speaker, and there's going to be a workshop where we're going to make kits, special hygiene kits that go to the Church World Service. There's also going to be a market area for people to buy things that other people have made from other churches. And this includes all the congregational churches of Massachusetts, Rhode Island, and Connecticut that are invited here. So it's a very special event for us. We do need some help, some cookie bakers, some people that will help serve lunch, some people that will help with cleanup. So if you're able to do that, there's a sign-up sheet in Fellowship Hall. And get your registration forms down there too. And all the women are invited, so come.
Other announcements?
One more. Well, next Saturday, for those of you who don't want to slog through the swamp with Bo and Kasia fighting off bugs and snakes and coyotes, 9 o'clock, we're going to be here cleaning up the church grounds. Bring a rake and some clippers, some gloves, and we're going to have a great time. Might be cookies.
Counterpunch over here in Bow. Let's do it.
I'm moving away from Linda for this announcement. Rob? But for those of you who don't want to be bossed around by Rob and rake leaves and deal with all that mud, we're going to do a half-hour trip from the church at 9:30 next week. I went down yesterday, and all the ephemerals, which are the early spring wildflowers that are rare, they were all up. I've never seen them up this early, so next week they should be in full bloom. And you know, bloodroot is an example, Dutchman's breeches, a lot of things, especially you gardeners, that you would love to see, and you will, once you see it, you will know what it is, and you can identify it in the future. So if you want to have fun, please think about coming with us at 9:30 next Saturday. Thank you.
You might want to start yours just like an hour later, so when they all return, they're captured. Any others? How about joys and concerns this morning?
I have a joy that I can share because Jeff's not here, but he retired at the end of last month, so we're really grateful for that. And also a concern, if you could keep in your prayers, Myra Finkelstein and her husband David, they're going through some tough times now with illness, so she would appreciate our prayers.
What was her first name?
Myra and David Finkelstein. Thank you.
I would love to share this joy with the congregation. I shared concern about my sister Pat, who had deep brain stimulation surgery due to her essential tremor, and the surgery was wonderfully successful. She can now write and cook and do everything again just like she used to. So thank you all for your prayers and share in our joy.
Others. Okay, thanks. If it's put. So it's a Sunday after Easter. What are y'all doing here? Ready to pray. See, that's why she's here for me. She's a plant. But when we come through that door, we come with our baggage. Some things we didn't do right during the past week, or maybe we had a harsh word for somebody, or somebody had a harsh word for us, and we're really a little angry about it. And this is a good time to let it go. Just to be really attentive to worshiping God. We have to first empty ourselves out so that we can be available to be filled with God. So let's join together in the prayer of confession. Lord, you call to our hearts the gentle words of peace, and yet so often we will not hear you. In our stressful world, you would give love and joy to our lives, yet we have doubts that your gifts are too good to be true, so we would not accept them. In love, you offer us life itself, but in our pride, we choose not to receive it. Forgive us, Lord. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray. Hear and believe these three words. You are forgiven. And give all thanks to God who is almighty. Amen. All right, would the kids like to come forward this morning? There, I get tired. So, who am I? I'm Pastor Barry.
Yeah.
How do you know that?
Because you tell everyone every Sunday.
Because I tell you all. That's right. And who are you?
I'm Nick.
How do I know that?
Because I told you.
But can you prove it?
my birthday.
I have to prove who I am all the time. I have a driver's license. So if I get pulled over by the police because they want to say good morning to me, I can show that I'm doesn't say Pastor Barry on that. It should, probably should. It would probably help, wouldn't it, if it said Pastor? And then sometimes if I go out of the country, I you have to have a passport. Anybody have a passport?
I do.
Prove it.
Yeah.
Anybody seen a passport?
I have one, so of course I have.
I don't have a passport.
Well, you should talk to your parents if you want to leave the country. I have a passport.
I never want to leave the country. Well, I go on vacation to Vermont.
Okay, that's good.
Where we go with the
So I also, so you ever see people in here have name tags on to identify who they are?
No.
No? Looks like this, see? I'm Ed Burgess. This says I'm Ed Burgess. Do I look like Ed Burgess?
No, he's over there.
He's over there somewhere. But I have the tag that says it's me, so it could be me, couldn't it?
No.
No? So all this identification doesn't work, huh? You know, sometimes I have to go to the medical, when I go to the doctors, they want to see my driver's license, and I can never figure out that because I've seen them many, many times, and they still don't know who I am. And they have x-rays, so they have a better picture than this thing, yeah? But sometimes, when Jesus' friends gathered after he died and was resurrected, you ever hear of Thomas? They call him Doubting Thomas because he went back to the upper room. And all the disciples were saying, we saw Jesus, he's alive, and he wouldn't believe them until he said, I have to see before I'll believe. And then Jesus appeared to him and said, see? And he looked at his body and he saw where the holes were from being crucified and cut in his side where he got stabbed. But we can't see that, can we? We can't see Jesus, can we? Not really, no. So we have to trust in other people who saw or believed and have told us since. And what is that called? Anybody know?
Faith.
Faith. Who said that?
Me.
You have ID. You want to sit here today? Go ahead. Whoa. But that's what we have to work on sometimes, is faith. That's all we have, is what other people have told us and that we trust that Jesus came for God. Ha. Huh. I'm funny, huh? You're not laughing with me, are you? You're laughing at me, I know that. They all do that to me on Sunday morning. Who wants to pray today? Oh, good. Well, let's stand up, form a circle, and we'll lead the whole church. Okay. Now, would anybody like to hold Pastor Barry's hand? I got two of them. Hold my finger? Can you hold my finger? Okay. Can we form a circle? Come on. We got to make the whole circle here. We got half a circle here. All right. Who wanted to start the prayer?
I will.
Oh. And your name again? Nick.
Our Father.
Who art in heaven? Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now I'm going to stay up for communion this morning before you go downstairs, right? Have I got that right? Okay. Well, I guess I'll just, everybody's going to hold on today. You can lead. Where are we going? Going that way? Right behind you. Brothers and sisters, perhaps the most decisive part of Jesus' ministry, certainly the most controversial, was his habit of choosing unusual people, some would say the worst of people, to sit down, break bread, and join him. Sitting at the table, people learned and grew in their understanding of God, and they were transformed. It's no different today. Jesus invites us to come, just as we are, sinners and saints, rich or poor, weak or strong. The only requirement is that we believe. As we gather together in Christ's name, we have that same opportunity to realize our faith, experience new life with all its wondrous possibilities, and become changed people, empowered by the Holy Spirit to go forth and be God's people, doing God's will. So let's pray. Holy God, we come before you filled with a sense of gratitude for your gifts of grace, mercy, love, and your empowering spirit. We are never more aware of these gifts than when we are gathered in fellowship at this table. Lord, we remember that the disciples were ordinary people just as we are ordinary people, changed by their response to your redeeming love, and that we too are offered the same redemptive love. Help us to accept it and respond to your love in our life. Teach us to live responsibly and responsively to the new freedom, and in the reality of your love that we may celebrate here this day much more. Amen. Hear now and remember the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. In the same way, after supper, he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup and said, "Do this in remembrance of me in the blood of Christ." My friends, we consecrate this bread, we consecrate this juice. And therefore, by your Holy Spirit, dear Lord, may these gifts and bread and wine bless us, that as we receive them at this table, we may offer you our faith and praise, and we may remain, and we may unite with God, Christ, and one another. Amen. This bread which we break is the communion in the body of Christ. And this cup of blessing which is poured out is the communion in the blood of Christ. My friends, these are the gifts of God for you who are the people of God. So come now. All things have been made ready. If you're able, please hold the bread till all have been served. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ that was broken for you. You may drink as you receive it if you like. This is the cup of new blessing poured out for you. And may our Savior Jesus Christ keep you and preserve you all to everlasting life. Amen. And let's rise for a round of blessed be the ties that bind.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred light, is light to that love.
Look at each other. Just look at each other. Can you believe it? You came out on a Sunday morning for this. And look who shows up with you. The most motley crew in town today. And God loves you. Amen. Thank you.
And now we listen to God's word, a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands and houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need.
This morning's gospel lesson is from the Gospel of John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. They are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." He then said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Let's pray. Holy God, may the words of my lips and the meditations that well up from deep within each of our hearts be truly acceptable to you. Amen. Now I'm going to tell you about something that happened in a different lifetime of mine a long time ago in the 1980s, or 70s maybe. When I was married to someone other than my gorgeous, beautiful, lovely, delightful wife, Wendy, I was married to someone who was of Polish extraction, lived in a three-family, multi-generational Polish family, and it was Jadziu, which was the grandfather, was 87 years old at the time. He was an immigrant from Poland. He only spoke two words, which I can't repeat here. And one day I was asked if I would sit with him while the family went to a wedding, because Jadziu couldn't be left alone in the house because he would start building things or tearing down things or generally being in a contractor frame of mind. So when he and I were sitting in the living room having a conversation that was totally incomprehensible to each other, we were just, you know, talking back across the room like, "Yeah, you know, blah, 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 blah." And I'd say, "Yeah, yeah, yeah, you know, blah." And it was going back. It was a wonderful conversation. Neither one of us knew or cared what the other one was thinking. That was fine. And then on the TV, there came a pictures of the moon landing. You all remember the moon landing? And that's, and I pointed to it and I said, "Men on the moon." And he used his two words, one of which starts with a B and one of which starts with an S. And he never in his whole life believed it was true that people had landed on the moon. Because we'd all seen science fiction movies on the TV all the time, right? It was just the same stuff. And he would never believe it. And he'd go like this, he'd stand up and he'd get excited like me. And he'd be animated about this was just BS. And then he just wouldn't believe no matter what anybody told him. And of course, nobody could tell him in Polish. Well, his daughter did, but it didn't work anyways. "Do you believe that people landed on the moon?" "Of course." "Why? Have you talked to somebody who was there?" "Huh? No." "You believe everything you see on TV?" "Huh. Aren't you something?" Suppose you were in a shopping mall and some students came up and asked you to be part of their psychology class experiment. You agree and allow them to blindfold you and place a cardboard box at your feet, pressing against your toes. And they ask you to determine without peeking if the box is empty or contains a kitten. What might you do? There are at least three ways to decide. First, you could put your hand on the box and feel around inside, right? Gaining knowledge by direct experience. You could pick up the box and judge from its weight or shake it a little to detect its motion. This would be gaining knowledge through reasoning and deduction. Or you could ask someone if there's a kitten in the box, which would be learning by believing or placing faith in the testimony of the person you were asking. Three ways of acquiring knowledge that are direct experience through our senses, reasoning or deducing, and believing the words of another person. Of those three, which do you think you most often use? Scientists say we acquire at least 75% of all of our knowledge by accepting the word of others. That shouldn't surprise us, really, should it? That seems pretty factual. Think of all the things each day you accept without ever experiencing actual source of the material. Does Antarctica exist? Have you been there? I don't know. Is it hot in the Sahara Desert? Might be, but I'm not sure. Is the Earth flat? Is Summer's Prison a good place to live? Is the sun too hot to do an overnight? There are many places for which we have no desire to go and check out personally, and we accept the words of others that they exist and how they might be. We learn of current events by faith. We read papers. We watch TV reporters. You may think it's more than faith because we get TV coverage, but Jaju, how can you believe any coverage if it's just another movie, right? Movies look real, don't they? They look pretty darn real. Some of us go to the movies to be scared, what's scared of us, so we must think it's real in some way, right? Three-fourths of what we know is based on faith or testimony of others, and that doesn't seem to faze us at all. But when you are, when asked by a rationalistic or scientific mind, how can you believe in God that you've never seen? Or how can you believe in the resurrection of Jesus? Science can't explain it, right? Science isn't going to explain it. More than 75% of all of our knowledge we accept is on the word of others. And our faith is based on the testimony of credible witnesses. It dates back to those apostles we heard about earlier. All but one, John, died as martyrs. Had they denied Jesus or simply kept quiet, they could have lived out their lives in peace. But without fear or hesitation, they proclaimed Jesus was the Lord and alive, one truly risen from the dead. And for that teaching and that teaching alone, they were willing to give up their lives. Throughout the Gospel of John, light and darkness are contrasted on at least three different occasions in the context of Jesus and his miracles. On a physical level, he has contrasted those who see things as they are to those who willfully blind themselves to the reality. On the cognitional level, he contrasts those who read the signs Jesus performs and correctly concludes he's the Son of God to those who misrepresent the good that Jesus does. And on the supernatural level, John contrasts those who accept the enlightenment of Jesus and believe to those who prefer the blindness of sin and denial. Up to this point in his gospel, many have been witnesses to the actions of Jesus and concluded from them that he truly was the Son of God and placed faith in him. Now John tells of another path. Thomas was absent when Jesus first appeared. They reported him as risen, but he refused to believe. He demands first-hand sensory experience. He wants to see Jesus with his own eyes and touch the wounds with his own hands. And when Jesus comes that second time, he's very stern with Thomas because Thomas is setting the worst possible example. Soon enough, people will no longer be able to experience the risen body of Jesus directly. If they are to believe, if the church is to continue and Jesus' mission accomplished, people will have to believe simply on the testimony of others. And Jesus tells Thomas, you have believed because you have seen. But there's a better way, Jesus continues. Blessed are those who have not seen and still believe. May it be so in your life and in mine. Amen. Let's pray. Busy time for us, God. We are out and about in our springtime energy, finding new things to do, cleaning up and fixing up and painting up and just being outside again. Thank you for the vibrancy of the new life that's coming up around us. We thank you for all those things that were planted in the fall but are now started to show themselves. We're joyful to hear the birds sing in an uproarious note every morning, and we know that there's hatchlings to come and new babies to be seen, and dear Lord, it's all started again. Very much like your life among us. You come into us and we grow and become new and vibrant and your people. So thank you for being our Savior. Thank you for coming amongst us, and thank you for letting us know of you. In many ways, we go about our lives and never speak of you. But dear Lord, you call us to. Call us to share what we believe with others so they might come to know you in a new way and have their lives grow in vibrancy. Holy One, we ask your blessing and your Spirit to be upon us as we go forth into the world that your name may be known. And dear Lord, we look at this world and we say, oh my goodness, what can we do here? And the first thing we trust is that our prayers make a difference. So this day we pray for those places at war and the people of Gaza and Ukraine and Russia and Israel. We pray for changed hearts in all sorts of places around the world where we know that hatred runs rampant sometimes, and the only way for it to be overcome is by the love and peace you offer. So where possible, show us how we can share that. And they are still those places in our prayers no matter what. And we pray for this community and for this state and country because of the wonders that we have here, the great people. And we ask that you help us overcome our differences to work together and share in that peace and love. And in our own homes, there is illness, needs healing in body, mind, and spirit. So dear Lord, we call upon you to come into our places of darkness and share new lightness. But we know much goes unspoken here that is in our hearts. So listen now, dear Lord, as we open our hearts to you. These things and much more, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And let us now receive the morning offering. Holy One, we make an offering before you. They represent our work, our time, and our efforts. Use them and us to your best purposes. Amen. My friends in Christ, it's a durable faith that dares to doubt, a bountiful faith that begins to believe, a sustaining faith that seeks to serve. May our companionship with Christ and with one another be primary sources of a good and growing faith. So go forth now, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.